When I stood on the very top of the world, on the very top of Mount Everest, I did not conquer Mount Everest at all. In my opinion, no one in this world can conquer Everest, or no one in this world can conquer any mountain. You can never conquer any mountain. It's the mountain that decides when you are going to get to the top or not.
My name is Kuntal Joisher and I am from Mumbai, India. Even though I'm a software engineer, I'm actually a passionate mountain climber as well. Software engineering is what I do to, you know, run my home, but mountaineering is what actually drives me. Even when I'm sitting right now here, I can actually hear my own heartbeat. So every time I'm in the mountains, I get this intense feeling, you know, this intense rush, this intense high. My idol always was Sherpa Tenzing or Sir Edmund Hillary. After, you know, the 1953 groundbreaking climb by Edmund Hillary and Tenzing, to me, you know, they were my heroes.
I have been born in a vegetarian family and I have always thought that, you know, I'm a compassionate person. If I am a compassionate person, then I have to be a vegan, and that's the only way I can be compassionate, and that's the only way I can be at peace with myself. One of the first things a lot of people, or a lot of mountain climbing community people, told me is that as a vegan, you won't be able to climb mountains. So there was a lot of pushback on what I was trying to do. But in my mind, I was very clear that if as a vegan, I cannot climb mountains, then I will not climb mountains. The challenging thing was that I was not able to find vegan gear easily. Now, over the period of years, I was able to find vegan alternatives to pretty much everything. Veganism actually has not been a hindrance at all. On the contrary, veganism has actually helped me become a lot better mountain climber. When I saw Everest in front of me, I was like, this is it. This is the dream of my life. This is the calling of my life. The last rays of sunset were falling on Everest. It was burning golden. It was as if Everest was on fire. It's, you know, almost like getting an intense high but without drugs. This is, you know, in October 2010, when for the first time in my life, I decided that I'm going to climb Everest. I think, you know, those seeds that were sown back, you know, few years, few decades ago, they were all there, and you know, I decided that I was going to climb Everest. Come whatever happens, I'm going to climb this mountain. The peak age of a mountain climber is 43. The whole idea is that by 43, you have seen so many things in your life. You have gone through so many ups and downs in your life. You have gone through so many successes and failures in your life that you are now able to better deal with so much downtime on the mountain. To succeed in climbing mountains, you have to have enormous amount of patience. An Everest expedition takes 65 days. So it takes 65 days to climb to the very top of Mount Everest. And out of the 65 days, you easily end up spending 30 to 35 days just waiting at the base camp. You are in your tent all day long, possibly just eating food and reading books, and just waiting for the right weather window to climb the mountain. In these 65 days, the total number of days that you actually end up climbing is about 10 days. A lot of times I've seen the youngsters on the mountain, they get very edgy, they get very nervous, they get very impatient that, why do we have to wait so much to climb this mountain? And during that time, they do several things and they get injured. Possibly they get altitude sick because they are running too fast on the mountain sometimes, and they end up going home. You know, I always thought that, you know, since I'd done a master's and you know, I used to work for a Los Angeles-based company, and aisa lagta tha ki, you know, koi life mein dhaad maar li hai maine. That is, you know, how I used to feel. There was this bit of ego also in me. But when I started climbing mountains, there are two things that happened to me. When are you in middle of these gigantic and majestic Himalayas, you really find your true place in the universe. You really figure out how small you are in the grand scheme of things. All your ego, it just completely gets killed. When you start climbing mountains and you start realizing that the mountains decide what the end is going to be, you completely lose your ego. Completely.
Shit.
The best exercise for mountaineering is mountaineering itself. And so over last 6 or 7 years, I spend a lot of my time throughout the year mountain climbing. And that's how, you know, I get ready for my big expeditions. If you have to climb Everest or if you have any other such dream in your life, you have to be razor sharp focused.
Final round. Trying to adjust my body to start burning fat instead of carbohydrates as its primary fuel.
During my physical fitness regimens, I had to push myself harder and harder. For example, a typical workout that I would do is I would climb 300 floors up and 300 floors down. At the end of the workout, I would be absolutely knackered beyond belief. It would be such a point that I would actually feel as if I'm going to pass out right now. And in these situations, I would actually tell myself that I would have to go and climb 50 floors more. And this was necessary because this was going to happen on Everest to me. But physical fitness is only 10% of the entire ballgame. Mental fitness is 90% of your success on these big mountains. If you put me on any rock face on this planet, however hard it is, whatever angle it is on, I can rappel even in my sleep.
Running in. I'm serious. Easily more than 40 degrees centigrade.
The very first time when I was at the base camp where I was camped right in front of Everest, when I first entered the dining tent, on the right hand side of the dining tent, there were about 10 to 15 pictures on the wall of the tent. I saw pictures of people's fingers that were amputated, pictures of people's feet that were amputated, pictures of people who had lost their nose, who had lost their cheeks completely, dead bodies lying on Everest for years and years, sometimes decades. One of the things I distinctly remember is my expedition leader coming and telling me, "Kuntal, these photos that you are seeing, if you ever decide to climb Everest in your life, just make sure that you don't end up on this wall. Kuntal, if you don't focus, then you're going to fucking die." This was April 25th, 2015, at about 11:55 in the morning. The seat that I was sitting on started shaking.
The ground is shaking.
A 7.9 magnitude earthquake had hit Nepal and had hit the base camp as well. What's going to happen next? And then we hear this loud boom, almost like a bomb blast happening somewhere. The sound of the boom was coming from towards Everest. All of us were standing and looking towards Everest. And in that time, something very unusual happened. There are all these climbers in the team that was in front of us that all started running towards Everest. So I'm standing here and thinking, if the danger is Everest, why would someone run towards the danger? It does not make any sense. The danger was actually behind us. That moment, all of us turned. And when we turned, I saw the most horrifying sight of my life. We were faced by this giant cloud. Left from the sky to the right of the sky, it filled the entire sky. We were faced by this giant block of snow and ice. In that moment, I didn't think that I was going to die. I was actually very certain that I was going to die. I was trying to, you know, breathe. But I could not breathe at all.
Fuck.
It's only, you know, like no air, but only ice particles going into my lungs. Almost felt as if someone had taken a plastic bag, put over my face, and almost was choking me.
Maybe in the kitchen tent.
Yeah, maybe. Right.
Stay together.
All the air from the environment had been sucked out. The guy who was next to me, a German climber named Jost Kabusch, was seeing my entire struggle. And in that moment, he told me, Kuntal, you can come inside my jacket and breathe.
Come under my jacket. Come under my jacket. Are you okay? Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
So I went inside his jacket and I started taking, you know, I started breathing. And of course, to my surprise, I was actually able to breathe. No problems whatsoever. And I realized that inside his jacket, there were still ambient pockets of air that I could go and breathe from. So I would go inside his jacket, I would breathe, I would come out, I would struggle, I would go inside his jacket, breathe again, come out, struggle. And this entire thing went on for 3 minutes as the avalanche passed over us. The entire base camp was devastated. Entire base camp was actually flattened. A Japanese couple walked in front of us and the Japanese lady's half of the face was just missing. Skin and bones, that's it. We quickly realized that initial estimates were about 6,000 people were dead, few hundred thousand were displaced from their homes. This was not a mountain climbing tragedy, it was a tragedy of unprecedented levels. As a team leader of the team, I had to take a decision. I spoke to the Sherpa team leader and our entire team wanted to go home. To be very frank, I was willing to wait one inconsequential year to come back again and climb that mountain. I attempted to climb Everest in 2014 and I failed because there was an avalanche. I attempted to climb Everest again in 2015 and I failed because there was an earthquake and an avalanche. And when I came back home, a lot of people told me that it is impossible, that you don't have what it takes to climb this mountain. But this was my dream, this was my passion, and this was my baby. When you are climbing Everest, between base camp and camp one, there is a section which is known as Khumbu Icefall. It is a section which takes about 12 and a half hours to pass through the first time. And every step that you take inside this Khumbu Icefall, you don't know whether you are going to be alive the next moment. A lot of people, you know, have seen the movie Everest. And in that, there is a very specific scene where a person is walking on top of a ladder. When I crossed my first ladder, it was a scary moment. There are 50 ladders on Everest. You can't be scared on every ladder, otherwise you are just going to go home. So you learn how to cross these ladders, you get over your fears, and you just keep crossing them over and over again. But these ladder crossings can become very routine after a certain point.
I will do it. Okay, Bhagwan, come. तुम कैसे पहुंच गए इधर दो घंटे में?
दो घंटा? वो मेरे पांच अभी कितना बज गया?
आठ.
आठ. दो घंटा नहीं. तीन घंटा लग गया.
हमको पांच घंटा लग गया.
But what is more scary is walking through Khumbu Icefall and not knowing when you are going to die next.
Right now, we are at Everest Camp 2. We are on our summit push. It's almost been 2 years we have been coming here and We have not gotten to this point. So here we are, finally at camp 2, going to camp 3 tomorrow, South Col the day after, and hopefully summit after that. We were on our final climb to the summit, and we were on a section where there were two ladders joined to each other. I had just finished crossing these two ladders, and I was standing at the base of a big ice tower. At this moment, I heard a bomb blast right on top of my head. In 2014, I survived an avalanche. 2015, I survived an earthquake and an avalanche. And now 2016, there is an avalanche right on my head. I was very certain I was not going to make through this avalanche, because a person can get lucky once, a person can get lucky twice. I was very certain I'm not going to get lucky thrice. And then the next thing I see is about less than 10 feet away from me, the avalanche passing. So, as much as I thought that I was not going to be third time lucky, I actually ended up being third time lucky.
Jitesh ji, aapka kya kehna hai last icefall trip ke bare mein?
I enjoyed that avalanche moment.
Oh, I didn't enjoy it at all.
When you are walking through the Kumbu icefall, this happens all the time. Right now at Everest Camp 3. Took us about 6 hours to get here. It was very windy, probably at times it even touched 100 kilometers per hour. And here's two other people on my team sharing tent.
One of my biggest fears is sleeping inside the death zone. Death zone is something that scientists have figured out, that beyond this altitude, human bodies cannot naturally acclimatize, or cannot acclimatize even with the help of bottled or supplementary additional oxygen. Every breath that you take inside the death zone, you are on borrowed time. The more time you spend inside the death zone, the more likely that you will not come back home. On Everest, there are several days where you have to walk 10, 12 hours at 28,000 feet where there's no oxygen whatsoever, and you feel as if you are going to die the very next moment, but you have to, you know, pull out that energy from somewhere and keep moving on and on and on. When we were at Camp 4, which is at 26,000 feet inside the death zone, it takes 45 minutes to boil half a liter of water. 45 minutes for half a liter of water. And in half a liter of water, two people have to survive a 20-hour round trip to the summit of Everest.
Congratulations, Kuntan. You're pretty strong, man. At South Col, it's about 5 o'clock in the evening, and we are getting ready for summit push in about 4 hours time.
I made it to the top of the world, but I ended up crying. I completely broke down on the very top of the world. And until I got to the very topmost point in the next 6 to 8 minutes, I kept crying every step that I took on the mountain. And then I wanted to do two most important things on the very top of the world. The first thing I wanted to do was I wanted to put a vegan flag on the very top of the world. I think a cause that changed my entire life. I thought that if I can get to the top of the world and tell the people that even a vegan can make it to the top of the world, then I could debunk several myths around this. The second thing I wanted to do was I wanted to make a phone call to my dad and I wanted to let him know that I made it to the top of the world. Now, my dad has been a dementia patient for the last 15 years and he has gotten to a point where he does not recognize that I am his son. He is completely bedridden and he does not possibly even remember his own name. So it was important for me to let him know that I made it to the top of the world. I don't think he would understand what Everest is, but I think there would possibly, he may have some idea that his son has achieved the biggest dream of his life. And if that brought a smile on his face, that is a huge, huge, huge thing for me. There will be a lot of obstacles, there will be a lot of failures, there will be a lot of difficulties in any journey that you take in life. But it is important to stay focused and not give up and keep pursuing until you make it to the top. When I got to the very top of Everest, I did conquer something. I ended up conquering a lot of my own limitations and I ended up conquering a lot of my self-doubts. I conquered my personal Everest.